Well, good afternoon, and welcome everyone to the 35th Annual Merton Lecture. The Merton Lecture Series began back in 1978. It was established when Sister Therese Lentfort passed away and donated the largest private collection of Merton writings and recordings that was known to exist. She donated it to the Catholic Campus Ministry Program here at Columbia, and thus began the establishment of the Merton Center in the basement of the Rectory of Notre Dame on the corner of Morningside Drive and 114th Street. The Merton Center is the basis, is one of the central places for campus ministry activities here at Columbia. And along with the establishment of the Merton Center began the establishment of the Merton Lecture. Now, the design of the lecture was not necessarily to study the writings and spiritual life of Thomas Merton. It was rather to celebrate the love that Thomas Merton had for learning, the seeking of personal holiness, and even working to share the love of God in our daily lives. Merton lectures have been given by distinguished members of the clergy, bishops, cardinals, religious. They've been given by writers and theologians. And the very first Merton lecture was actually given by a Benedictine brother, David Steindl Rast. And in it, in his lecture, he quoted Thomas Merton as having said, or rather having prayed, "If you send me work, I shall embrace it with joy, and it will be rest to me, because it is your will. And if you send me rest, I will rest in you. Only save me from myself. Save me from my own private poisonous urge to change everything. Let me rest in your will and be silent. This is what I live for. Amen, amen." Well, that brings us to this afternoon's speaker. Clara Gaymard has certainly done plenty of work, and she has embraced it with joy and with faithfulness and love. She is a devoted mother, a loving daughter, the CEO of GE in France, and she's here today to speak about the book that she wrote about her father, Life is a Blessing. So without further ado, please welcome Clara Gaymard.
Dear Father, dear everyone, I'm very happy to be there, and I must say I'm really amazed because you are coming in a rainy day to listen to a woman you don't know speaking about a man you don't know. And so I understand that it is because of the reputation of this lecture that you are here today, and I hope that when you will leave this room, you will be happy to have learned about a man called Jerome Lejeune, who is the purpose of my few words today with you. My father, Jerome Lejeune, died the day of Easter. It was the 3rd of April in 94. And 2 days before, it was on the Holy Thursday, I went and see him with my husband and my brother. And I didn't believe he would die, but I knew that, as he said to us, something would happen on Easter. And since I thought it was not my mom's job to speak about what would happen if he died, we start to discuss with him. And I said to him, you know, what do you want to us to do if you die? And would you accept that I would write a book about you? And since he was a very humble man, I thought he would say no. And he said yes, if it's about to give a testimonial about all the children I've been fighting for, the very small, the babies who are not born yet, and the other children who are more children than the others, I mean the one who has a Down syndrome, yes, you can. And he could barely breathe, and he told me one thing that I really want to share with you, because he said, you know, my children, I want to leave you one thing. We are in the hand of God. I have had this experience several times in my life. And since he could speak only very slowly, he said, the details have no importance. But believe me, we are in the hand of God. And it is with this word that I want to share with you my experience of a daughter, of a man who, when he was born, had nothing exceptional, but had an exceptional destiny. As a young boy, he was born in a very classical family that you can find in France. Her mother was a very clever mother. She loved music, but she was staying at home. He had two brothers. His father was a lawyer and was going to work every day, was a man who was a lot of culture. But he went to school like any other boy with his brothers, with his brother. Of course, the war arrived. And his father took one decision that has started to really build the mindset of my father. My grandfather decided that during the war, they won't go to school anymore. They were far away from the school. They were living on the countryside. And he gave them lecture, read the classic authors, learn Latin and Greek, and stay at home and study by themselves. And by the way, it's the way that he learned English afterwards. When becoming a scientist, he discovered that the only way to share the science was to learn English. And doing that, when he was 14 years old, 15 years old, has built a man who was able by himself to understand the beauty of the culture, the beauty of the nature, and has made him a man who always has been in contemplation, admiration of what the human thinking can do, and also what the nature is giving to us. And it was maybe during those years that came the vocation for him to be a doctor. There was no doctor at all in the family, but he wanted to be a surgeon. And you know, the life is sometimes very ironic because he made his medical study, and as I was coming with Elise in taxi, and she told me how long the study are here in US, it was the same for him. But to become a surgeon, he had to pass an exam at the end of the study. He tried once, he missed it. He tried the second one, he missed it. And the third time, when he thought he was really prepared, he took the subway in the wrong way. So he couldn't pass the exam, and he never became a surgeon. So he came into a lab, and he discovered those children that we call the Mongolism at this time, because they were looking at from this side, the Europe side. I like the Mongol. I know that in the Mongol they call them the Europeans, so the opposite. And he, at this time, the children with Down syndrome, I don't know how it was in US, but in Europe, a lot of things were said about this pathology. First of all, that the mother had certainly bad behavior because it should come from the syphilis cause. So every time a woman would come with a child with Down syndrome, the first thing that the doctor had to do is a test of syphilis. And because you could see on their face that they had an handicap, people would hide them. So they would stay apart with no education, with no, you know, kind of shame on the family. And my father really took in affection those children, and he became a researcher because he wanted to understand why. And at this time, it was in 58, no one could imagine that the cause of the Down syndrome could come from genetic. We knew barely nothing about genetics. But a guy in Japan was able to put on the paper flat the 46 chromosomes that human beings have. I'm speaking, I suppose, in front of some people who are making medicine, so that know much better than me that. And we discovered that the having those chromosome flat was the way to understand what is our DNA, our patrimony that we all have. And it was on a very old microscope that he refurbished in a way that he discovered that for the one who had a Down syndrome, they didn't miss anything. Their genetic patrimony was the same that ours, but they have one chromosome more on the 21 chromosome, you know, they go by two. And it's why instead of calling that the syndrome of Lejeune, which is normally the case that we do, Down syndrome is the name of the Dr. Down, he decided to call it the trisomy 21. And doing that, he opened the door of the new genetic. It was the first time that we understood that a disease could be caused by a genetic cause. He made this discovery in June. At this time, he was very young. He was 34 years old. And he was already well known here in US because he has been selected as an expert on the radiation at the NATO organization. So he went already back and forth here in US, and because of that, he was asked to be a visiting professor during the summer. So he came in US in several places, in California, in New York, in Chicago. And every time he made the lecture that he had to make, he showed the picture. And see, you can see on this paper that when you put the chromosome flat, you see that the children with the Down syndrome has one chromosome more on the line 21. Everyone could have stolen his discovery, but he was young and no one believed him. So he came back and he published it in January 59, and that became the huge discovery of the last century and opened the door of the research of genetics. And it's thanks to that that in 61 he received the Kennedy Prize. So it's this year, the 50th anniversary of the Kennedy Prize he received here in New York. For the funny story about it is that at this time my mother and my father were, you know, it was 15 years after the war, they were not wealthy. So when President John Kennedy invited him to receive the prize, he came alone. And the president asked him, why do you come alone? You should come with your wife. And my father didn't dare that, he didn't have the money to pay the ticket. But so my mother was invited the year after to see the president. And of course, she couldn't come because the year after the President Kennedy was died. So with this discovery, he started to open the first chair of genetics in France. He was going to US very often, to Israel also, and he was teaching how to build a team of genetics in many places of the world. And when he came home, sometimes he came with American teachers, American researchers, having discussion, having lunch at home. And we are living in a house which has been built before the discovery of America. So it was, I remember when I was a child, I could see those very, you know, eminent professor, very sophisticated people, going into a house that was built before the discovery of America. So that was always quite a moment of emotion when they went up the staircase and see a middle-aged house where a lot of history has been happening in this house. And with that, he became one of the most famous and well-known scientists in France, and one of the most famous and well-known geneticists in the scientific community all over the globe. And in 1969, he came here in the US, and the NHS was thinking about abortion already at this time. And he made a speech, and he was at this time already familiar with the American language, and he made a kind of joke, let's say, saying to the NHS that if the NHS was giving authorization to make abortion, it won't be the National Institute of Health, but the National Institute of Death. And he wrote a letter to my mother, as he did every evening when he was traveling, and he said, "Tonight, I know that I lost the Nobel Prize because of that." And 2 years later in France, we had a debate about abortion. And the debate started with a movie where a young girl has been raped and wanted to get abortion and, you know, was not able to get it. And after, there was a debate. And a member of the parliament was proposing a law where the abortion should be allowed for rape and for handicapped children. And the only handicapped children that we could detect before the birth were the one with the Down syndrome. Thanks to a discovery made by a professor called the Professor Lilly, that lived in New Zealand, that was able to make the discovery of the amniocentesis. And with the discovery of the Professor Lilly, who was wanting with this discovery to help the health, and the discovery of my father, they were both Catholic. Those two discoveries together was making able to make an early diagnostic and to kill them. And one day, he came back home for the lunch, and he was white. And it was just a day after the submission, and he said, I had on my consultation a mother who came with his child who is 10 years old. And the child is named Bruno, and he knew him for a long time. And Bruno was crying. And he said, "Why do you cry?" And the mother said, "You know, Bruno looked at the television yesterday, and he has listened to the debate. And that this time, this little boy of 10 years old jumped in the arm of my father and said, 'My professor, they want to kill us. You have to protect us. We are too weak to do it by ourselves.'" And my father told us during the lunch, and he said, "If I don't protect them, me who want to discover the way to cure them, I'm not a good guy." And it's why he started. He could have stayed saying, "I'm a doctor, I'm a scientist, I'm against abortion." And I stay there. And I complain because it's not good what we're doing. But he did not. He raised up. And I can tell you, he was absolutely alone to do that. All his friends, all the other doctors, all the scientists around, even if, in particular, in one-to-one, they said, "It's a crazy law, we shouldn't do that, it's not what we have signed with the Hippocrates," they didn't move. and he raised. And the way he did it was not about judging anyone. He was not saying, you know, to the woman who aborted, you are guilty, you should not do that, and so on. Not at all. The first thing he did is to create an association in a house where the woman who wanted to give birth and where didn't have the condition of life or had a child with a disease or whatever, they could stay there during the pregnancy, have someone to help them, give them a job, helping them to just to start the life of the baby. And the other thing that he did is to make always the same testimonial, saying that the science can prove that being a geneticist, anyone is unique. And it's not only the Bible who is saying that, it's not only the religion who is doing that, it is the science. Every life is unique. Every life starts at the very moment of the conception. Yes, it's a very little life. But at the conception, at the very early stage, it's not a monkey. It's not a chicken. It's a human being. You like it or not, it is the reality of the life, that the life starts at the conception. And at the very starting point, when the two cells comes together, all your genetic patrimony is already there. At this very moment of the starting of the human being, it is decided if you will have blue eyes, if you will have dark hair, if you will be tall, if you will be short, if you like mathematics, or if you better like literature. This is your genetic patrimony, which is there at this very beginning. At the moment of the time when the woman don't know even that she's pregnant, doesn't know even that she's pregnant, the life is there, it's a human being, and this human being is, this human is being, is a human. He used to say that the small of the human is human. So he took it on the scientific point of view, not as a Catholic, not as someone who say what is the ethic. He said it as a doctor, as the one who is here to protect the smallest. I have to just to tell the truth. So it was very difficult to be against him. And since he was a very good speaker, that he had a great sense of humor, and you couldn't find anything in his life that you could contest, you know. He was attacked like the devil. He was accused to be against the Jewish about, you know, about the war, anything that was completely untrue. But he was the one you had to kill because he was saying the truth. So this period of time, I was 12 years old, and I was going by bicycle at school every time on the same way. And it happened that the way I was going to school on my bicycle was going in front, close to the university where my father had his office and where he made his research. And one day I was with my sister, my elder sister, by bicycle there, and paint on the wall, big in black, was paint, "We have to kill Lejeune and his monster." So I came back home and I said to my father, "They want to kill you." And he said to me, "No, no, no, don't worry, it's only words. Don't worry." But just to tell you that it was time where a lot of violence, I know that in US there is also a strong violence against on the pro-life and the pro-choice, but at this time it was very, very tough. And because of that, he It was very complicated for him to get any money to make his research, but he continued to stay in France. He had offers to come here to US, he had offers to come in other countries, but he decided to remain there for one reason, one main reason. And the main reason is that he had in his consultation 9,000 children coming to visit him, and he knew the first name of each of them. So every time someone was coming, he said, Pierre, Paul, Geraldine, the name of the child. And for them, he couldn't leave the country. There was a lot of children coming from abroad with their parents to his to the hospital. But for them, he remained there. And when after he died, we had a lot of testimonials. You know, he didn't speak about what he did because he kept the secret as a doctor. But we had a lot of testimonial, and the testimonial, one of the testimonial was always the same. You know, when you are parents and you are giving birth, and you discover when your child is born, that your child is different than the other. And with the Down syndrome, you don't see it when you are not used to it. You don't see it really at the first moment when you are parents. Of course, when you're a doctor, you see it. So after the birth, they would have the announcement of the fact that their children has a Down syndrome, and people will tell them that they won't be able to go to school, they don't want to be able to speak or to have a normal life and so on, that it will be drama and so on and so on. And those poor parents are coming to the hospital to see my father, who was the specialist. A disaster, you know, try to understand this feeling of a parent coming with the child where the doctor has told them that there is no future. And my father took a chair, asked the mother to wear a white blouse, asked the mother to sit, and took another chair in front of the mother, sat in front of the mother, and put the baby in between on the knees of the mother, and calling the baby by his name, and making the consultation of the baby, calling him by his name on the knees of the mother. And many parents have told us that it was at the very moment when he was doing that, that they were understanding that they were their child. It was not a sick person, it was their child. Yes, the child was sick, but they suddenly could love him because it was a person, it was a human being with a man, with a name, with a love, with a destiny. Even if the destiny would be maybe different than the others. And because of that, you know, my job is to be CEO of an American company in France. I'm selling gas turbine, I'm selling aircraft engines. Yes, I'm selling medical products. But I'm living in an environment which is not at all the one my father wore. Every time I'm traveling, everywhere on the globe, I meet someone who have heard about my father, have met my father, and come and say to me, your father has changed my life, or your father has changed the life of our family, my sister, of my brother, and so on and so on and so on. Just because his way of being a doctor and a scientist was always to put the person in first. Yes, technology, yes, science, yes, to bring the best to the people, but only on the benefit of the people. I want to share with you two other aspects of my father, and after, I think the best way is that you ask questions But there are two other aspects I want to share with you. The first one is how he was as a father. Since I was born, and we were five children in my family, I knew that my father was, let's say, I wouldn't say exceptional, because he was absolutely normal. He was humble, he had a great sense of humor, he was just a normal father. But the way he looked at us, you would see so much love, so much tenderness, that, you know, there is not one single day when I was a child that I didn't know that he loved me. What is the best gift that you can give to a child? That he knows every day that he's loved. It's the only thing which is important for a child. And that is something that he gave us every morning, every day. And even if he was a great doctor, a great scientist with a big consultation, lots of research and so on, he was there for the breakfast, he came back for lunch, and he was there for the dinner. And when he was late, my mother would tell me, "You were late." So he refused any, you know, lunch, professional lunch or professional dinner. He would do them at home. And for us, that has been absolutely marvelous, because we have met so many smart people, because they would come and have dinner or lunch at home, and as soon as we wished and we wanted it, we could participate to that. My father was, of course, a Catholic, but the way he educated us was not, was by the example. He never said to us that we had to go to the Holy Mass every Sunday, but I would say he never gave us that as an obligation, never said the word. But matter of fact, we went. It was something that was absolutely natural, that came like the prayer of the evening, where we were kids, where before going to bed, he called us. We were in front of my mother's and father's bed, make a short prayer. It was not long, but it was the time where we were all gathered there, a family moment to pray together, and after everyone would go to bed. And my brother was sometimes more, you know, not very calm, so he would take them, one of them in front of him, and just join their hand in his hand, so they calm down and they pray. But I never heard my father saying, "You are stupid, you should be there, be on your knees," and so on, just this way. And that has given us, without any, you know, how can I say that, you know, or you should do that, never, never this way. Just the example of behaving, living his faith in a very natural way, praying, I suppose, all the time, but not saying it, that we had the natural experience that what God was in the middle of our life. And in 1974, the Pope, Paul VI, asked him to be the member of the Pontifical Academy of Science. So he joined this academy, and this academy is gathering scientists from everywhere. Some of them are not Catholic, just to give the church the information, the very latest information about the science. And when Jean GP2 became Pope, he invited my father and my mother for lunch, and they discussed about science, and they became friends. On the 13th of May, 1981, my mother and my father had a lunch with the Pope, and they had a discussion about science and so on, and about what should we think about the cloning, about, you know, what is coming now. And they left the Pope, they took a taxi, went in the plane back to Paris, and it's only when they were in the taxi back to the house that they heard that the Pope has been attacked and was between their life and death. And that this evening my father became sick and had to go to the hospital. He had the surgery at the same time as the Pope. He was at the hospital the same day as the Pope. And for us it was like, I don't know. He didn't want to believe in that, but it's like, you know, something that in parallel, those two life suspending, and they came out of the hospital on the same day. But when the Pope came to Paris, even if my father was received by the Pope nearly every month when he was coming to Rome, my father went with us as a normal pilgrim to the Holy Mass in Le Bourget. We spent the night there waiting for the Pope. It was raining and so on. And I said, you should be with a very important person. And he said, no, I'm a pilgrim like the others. So he was in the middle of, you know, the thousands and thousands of people being with us, instead of being at the first rank like all the officials would be. It was his way to be a Christian. And when he died, the Pope, in the morning of Easter, you know, the Pope is making a lecture at 10 o'clock in Rome. And one of a friend of my father called us and said, what is happening to Jerome? I could see on the face of the Pope that he was sad. And it's the way he understood that my father was dead. And a couple of years after, the Pope came back to Paris, and he asked, and I think he has done that only there, he asked to pray on the tomb of, his friend, Jerome Lejeune. So we organized that. At this time, the church, the French church, didn't want it, said it would be a lot of opposition, because my father was against abortion and so on, it would be complicated and so on. But at the end, they accepted. And we negotiate with them the fact that some handicapped children could come to the visit of the Pope on my father's tomb. It was in August, it was very hot. I think the police has put about, I don't know, 3,000 policemen around the cemetery for nothing. We were only 30 of us, you know, the family and some handicapped children with us. But it was really like protected like, I don't know, the American president. And the Pope prayed on the grave of my father, and there was a young black boy called Roland, who is handicapped, has a mental disease. And Roland has, when he came in the house where he lives now, he was a child, he didn't speak. And the only way that he got to speak was to give him a tam-tam so he could make tam-tam and laughter, he joined the other. And he, at the starting of his life, he was speaking by himself at the third person, because he couldn't see himself in a mirror, understand that he was a person. But Roland has grown up and now is an educated man. He is living alone, having his flat, going, working. And he's doing well, you know, even if he's a handicapped man. But the Pope took him apart and told him something. And Roland, since this time, say, the Pope speak to me and told me a secret. And everyone is asking him, what is the secret? And Roland, who is handicapped, has always kept the secret. And I'm wondering, and I mean, I want to end with that, because I want you to have the opportunity to ask questions. And I'm wondering if I had, me with my brain, and been as courageous as Roland, being able, having the Pope telling me something, saying to me this is a secret, to keep the secret. I'm not that sure. I don't know. Who of us has always kept the secret that we have received from other people? This is a question. So with that, I would be happy to just discuss with you and answer your questions, and you are willing to know more about Jerome Lejeune. Yes? He lived in, you know Paris well?
Yes.
Yeah, so you know Notre Dame? Yes. It's very close from Notre Dame. It's an area where the house hasn't changed since Middle Age. So the street is called Rue Galande. And the story of this house is quite funny, because it's a house which we call, was a kind of hat, so we call a pignon. So you have only 10 houses in Paris still having a pignon like that. And it was named the Street of the Three Virgin. And there was a thief called, that was a kind of a Robin Hood, the French Robin Hood, called Cartouche, that lived there. And we always thought that we would find a treasury one day in this house. And one day we had my parents were able to get another floor, because the family was growing. And one day one of the workers didn't came. So we went to see what he was doing. And there was a box from the Middle Age there, with big holes where there would have been some big pieces of gold. But of course the worker took it and never came back. So. We don't know if there is another treasury, but the history of this house is, you know, part of the memory. And the grandfather, my father, bought this house just before the First World War, and he didn't know that it was a very bad acquisition, because all this area should be destroyed. You know, Haussmann Paris, the big Haussmann Paris, and all this part should be destroyed. And the war arrived, and this part has never been destroyed, so at the end of the day, it was a good acquisition. Yes?
Thank you.
So first of all, he was telling the story of Tom Thumb. Do you know the story of Tom Thumb? You have never heard that? It's a novel we tell with this to the small child in Europe. And it's a story of a man who is that tall. You have certainly heard about that. And he said, you know, the story of Tom Thumb is the reality. Because when you look at the side, during the pregnancy, after 2 months of pregnancy, the child is not that high. And even with this high, he has everything. He's already nearly finished. The only thing he does is to grow. Now we know that. You know, every mother who has been pregnant can see, even in 3D, the image of the child growing and being a little human being. But at this time, we didn't have the echography the same way we have. So it was the way he did it. And by the way, you give me the opportunity to tell you about something that I forgot to tell you. It was in, I don't remember really the year, but I think it was in 84 or something like that. My father was alone in Paris. We were on vacation, and he took the opportunity of the vacation to work on his research. And he received a phone call from an American friend called Martin Palmer. And Martin Palmer was on vacation too. And he wanted to eat crabs. So he bought a newspaper to open the crabs. And to use it as a, you know, for the dirty things, you know. And on the newspaper he wrote something, he read something about a case opposing a couple that wanted to divorce. And they were okay for everything. But there were one thing they were not okay, is that the woman couldn't have children, so she had made a medical assistance pregnancy, you know, and there were 7 embryos who were somewhere in a hospital. And the man was asking to destroy them, saying, I don't want to have any children from this woman because I'm divorcing her. And she was saying, I want to keep them. So Martin and the judge was saying, I have to decide if they are human beings or they are things. If they are things, we divide them in 2 parts like everything. If they are a human being, it's different. This case happened in a city called Maryville. The woman was called Mary. The judge was Mr. Young, Judge Young, and I don't remember who it was, but his name was Christian. So, and Martin Palmer called the judge and said, what do you need? And the judge said, I need an expert. And Martin Palmer said, I know one. He's based in France. When is the case? When is the session? He said, it's after tomorrow. So he called my father and said, you have to come. And my father, it was in the middle of August, he said, I am my research, I can't come. And Martin Palmer told him, yes, you have to come, it's impossible. And my father called the airplane and the Air France, and Air France was saying there was no room in the plane. Anyway, and having the discussion with Martin Palmer, my father asked him, what does the mother say? And this Mary, who had those 7 embryos, said to the judge, I don't care if I'm not the mother of this embryo. Even if you give them to another mother, it's okay, but I want them to come to life. And my father suddenly said, he is 20, 2,000 years after the judgment of Solomon, it's a new judgment of Solomon. So I have to go. He gave another phone call to Air France, and suddenly one seat was free. And he came to Maryville, and he made his testimonial. Of course, in a much completed way than I'm able to tell you today, about the fact that embryons were human beings and not things that you can destroy. And that has been the first step in the US about giving by the science the proof that the embryons are human beings. So to answer your questions, he had a lot of attacks. His reputation has been certain way destroyed. And I remember when he was attacked in the press, like being, you know, the worst accusation you can make in France is to say that you are called revisionist, that it means that you don't agree that there has been Holocaust in Europe. So he was accused of being a racist and against Jewish, and so, which was absolutely not true, of course. And I remember one day I was telling him, why don't you say the truth? Why don't you say that it's... why do you accept that they accuse you this way? And he answered me, you know, I'm not there to protect my reputation. I'm here, my only fight is to protect the one I want to cure. And we will cure them one day. But first of all, we have to protect them. And I said to him, you know, the best way to protect them is to have a good reputation. And he said, maybe you are true, my daughter, but I'm not able to do that. So we didn't agree on this point. I said, I really believe I was not, I was 13 years old, and I said, you should defend yourself. But he didn't do it.